Now I want to talk about the spectrum and the spectral theorem of our operators, in particular, of course, the self-adjoint ones. That's the ones in which we're really interested. And the spectrum will be very important for our operators, also in a physical context, because, I mean, self-adjoint operators will correspond to measurements, and the possible outcomes of the measurements will correspond to the spectrum of the corresponding operator. Okay, and so we have really to see what the mathematical structure we have is there behind. And let me start and motivate this from the finite dimensional setting, where spectral theory is just, for matrices, it's just talking about the eigenvalues and the diagonalization of symmetric matrices. So we want to see this in general in infinite dimensions, and in particular also for unbounded operators. So this will be a section where I try to summarize what one knows about the spectrum and the spectral theorem in such a setting. So I'm not going to give all the proofs, but I hope to convey the main ideas and results. But let us start from the finite dimensional situation. So a finite dimensional Hilbert space. And then if I'm looking on the operator there, then necessarily this operator is bounded. In finite dimensions, every linear operator is bounded, and the operator corresponds to a matrix. After having chosen the basis in my Hilbert space, I can identify operator, a linear operator with a matrix, and then of course we are in the usual linear algebra setting. So then this operator, okay, is in B of H, and A corresponds to a matrix. Yeah, and then the spectrum of A, what is the spectrum of A? Those are just the eigenvalues. So the spectrum of A, which usually we denote by sigma of A, so this is a set of complex numbers which are just given by the eigenvalues of A. Of our matrix, yeah, and yeah, eigenvalues will correspond somehow to possible values of measurements given by a measuring device which corresponds to this A. So that's really the guys we are interested in. Yeah, so that's the spectrum, and then there is the spectral theorem which tells us that if I have, let's say, a symmetric matrix, I can actually diagonalize it, and then I get a matrix where the eigenvalues are on the diagonal. So the spectral theorem, also basic result from linear algebra, let's say for self-adjoint operators, that's the only ones in which we're interested, this corresponds on the level of the matrix to a diagonalization of my matrix A. Yeah, and our goal will now be to generalize those two things, this notion of the spectrum and the spectral theorem, to infinite dimensions. And in particular, in infinite dimensions, one has such theories for bounded operators, but one also has it for unbounded operators. And we want to understand the one actually for unbounded operators. So that's our big goal in this chapter. So generalize this to the infinite dimensional setting, so to a Hilbert space which has infinite dimensions, and in particular there we are particularly interested in unbounded operators. And unbounded operators. Yeah, so let us first think about the spectrum. So what do I mean with the spectrum of a matrix? And maybe let me write this down. So lambda in the spectrum, so this is an eigenvalue of my matrix. So this is an eigenvalue of my matrix A. And what does this mean? That lambda is an eigenvalue, it means that I have an eigenvector such that the effect of A on this eigenvector is just multiplying this eigenvector with lambda. And of course, the eigenvector should be non-trivial, because I mean, zero is multiplied under A with any number. So what the existence of an eigenvalue of A means, that lambda is an eigenvalue of A, means that we have an eigenvector. So this is a vector which is different from zero. So usually we can normalize it to have length 1. But the point is it should be different from zero, such that the effect of A acting on X is just multiplying this X with lambda. And of course, we can also rewrite this in terms of the operator A minus lambda. So namely, this means that we have an X different from zero, such that A minus lambda acting on X is equal to zero. Just bringing this lambda on the other side. And of course, with lambda, I always mean lambda times the identity operator. So lambda acts on X by just multiplying it with lambda. Okay, and now, this of course means that the operator A minus lambda is not injective. Because this means we have here something in the kernel of A minus lambda, which is not zero. So this means that it's not injective, and actually in finite dimensions, this means it's actually not invertible. Of course, if I have this, if it's not injective, it's of course not invertible, but furthermore, being not invertible is the same as being not injective. So here I'm using the fact that I'm in finite dimensions, that this is actually equivalent to the fact that A minus lambda is not invertible. Being not invertible means not being bijective, and this could have two reasons, namely it could be not injective or it could be not surjective. But for linear operators, one of them is equivalent to the other. So usually, if in finite dimensions, if you want to think about the surjectivity, it's usually easier to think about the injectivity because this is just given by an eigenvalue equation. Yeah, so maybe let me just write this down again explicitly, because this is one of the crucial main differences between finite and infinite dimensions, that in finite dimensions, linear mappings, the injectivity is actually the same as surjectivity, and this means it's the same as bijectivity. So the invertibility of an operator in finite dimensions, a linear operator in finite dimensions, is just a question whether it's injective or not. Because if it is injective, then it's automatically surjective, and if it is not injective, then it can also be not surjective. Okay, so here we have that injective is the same as surjective, so each of them is the same as bijective. Okay, so the question whether it's invertible can be decided as you like, either by checking whether it's injective or whether it's surjective. Yeah, and of course, so we can say checking whether lambda is in the spectrum for a matrix means essentially checking whether it's injective, but this is the same as checking whether it's invertible or not. Okay, and now the correct generalization of the eigenvalue to infinite dimensions is the checking whether it's invertible. That's really what we want, to see whether our operator A minus lambda is invertible or not. Yeah, so the correct, let's say, of course we have to justify, of course we could also just look on eigenvalues, and we will do this for operators on infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces, but that's not all. The spectrum, the possibilities of the values it can take on and the measurements so are really determined not just by eigenvalues but by more, namely by things which don't satisfy this invertibility. Okay, so the correct generalization of the notion of eigenvalues infinite dimensions is actually the question whether A minus lambda to the minus 1 does exist or not. Okay, so does not exist corresponds to what eigenvalues do in finite dimensions. Yeah, and so maybe let me now give right away the definition in our infinite dimensional and also unbounded setting of the notion of a spectrum. Yeah, and usually, I mean, instead of saying things don't exist, it's usually nicer to say that they exist. So we start with defining the situation where this exists, and this is called the resolvent set, and then the complement of this is the spectrum. So here is our definition. Yeah, so we consider an operator, a linear unbounded operator, on a Hilbert space H. So the operator is defined on its domain, which is dense in H, and it goes to H, yeah? So linear operator. And of course, we need some nice analytic structure. And for unbounded operators, this was the fact that the operator should be closed. A bounded operator, of course, is very nice, but usually we don't have bounded operators. We have unbounded operators, but we have some continuity properties there, and this is given by the fact that we have a closed operator. So we are only interested in closed operators. So, or also maybe sometimes in closable operators, but then we just close them, and essentially we can reduce closable operators to closed ones. Good, so let T be a closed operator. And then I first define the resolvent set. Yeah. So the resolvent set of T is the following set of complex numbers. Eigenvalues here are a priori complex numbers. So I'm looking for complex numbers. So I have it also here. So I denote the resolvent by rho of T. So what is this? So those are complex numbers such that T minus lambda as an operator, so this is defined. What is the domain of T minus lambda? It's the same as the domain of T, because the subtraction of lambda times the identity has no effect on the domain. So this is the domain of T, and it goes to H, the linear operator. Yeah, and this is a nice and good operator or good situation if this guy here is actually a bijection, so that we can take the inverse. And furthermore, maybe the surprising thing is that we require the inverse should be a bounded operator, not just an unbounded operator, but we really require a quite strong condition on the inverse. We will see later why this is the correct way of doing this. So we ask that this is a bijection. So this means it's injective and surjective. So we can take the inverse, and the inverse T minus lambda to the minus one should really be a bounded operator. Good, that's the good situation, the lambdas where everything is nice, and then the lambdas where not everything is nice, and those are the interesting lambdas, are the ones for which this is not true. And it's a complement of this set, and this is usually denoted by sigma and called the spectrum. So this is, here's the resolvent set, and it's complement, so it's denoted by sigma. So those are the complex numbers which are not in the resolvent. So it's C without the resolvent set. This is called the spectrum. So this is the spectrum of T. Yeah, and now we can divide the spectrum into subsets. Now we can think, the spectrum is defined by the fact that the inverse of our operator does not exist as a nice operator. Okay, so this means, and there can be different reasons. In finite dimensions, the only reason is it's not injective, which is the same as not being surjective. But now, of course, not being surjective or being surjective is not enough to guarantee the existence of the inverse. So we can divide the fact that we are in the spectrum, or the possibilities why we are in the spectrum, we can divide this into different possibilities. And this means we decompose the spectrum into three possibilities corresponding to the reasons why our operator doesn't have this nice inverse. So the spectrum of our operator, sigma of T, can be written as a disjoint union of three sets, and we call them, okay, sigma of t is written as a union, so the first set we call the point spectrum, sigma p, the second set we call the continuous spectrum, sigma c of t, and the rest we call the residual spectrum of t. Yeah, and of course we have to say what those guys are. And the first one, the point spectrum, that's just the ones where we have really eigenvectors. So that's really what we are, what we know from the finite dimensional classical situations. So the sigma p of t, so those are the lambdas in C for which we really have eigenvectors. So there is an x different from zero such that Tx is equal to lambda x. Okay, and this means of course that the operator t minus lambda is not injective because we have, there is an x in the kernel. That's exactly what this here is saying. We have an x in the kernel. So this means the inverse of t minus lambda does not exist because our operator is not injective. Yeah, so this set is called the point spectrum. And this is really what you are used to from finite dimensions. Yeah, but then in infinite dimensions, there can happen more. So it's not just that the injectivity can be a problem, but also the surjectivity. Yeah, and for the surjectivity, so of course we need that the range of my operator, yeah, what is it? It can be all, can be the whole Hilbert space, or it can be dense in the whole Hilbert space, or it can be far away from being dense. So it's just a subset which is not even dense. Yeah, and somehow the most interesting situation which can happen and which is a typical thing which gives us elements in the spectrum is that if the range is dense, but the operator, the inverse, is not bounded on this domain. And that's really the question. I mean, in this situation, we can still define an inverse of t minus lambda as an unbounded operator. So you might think, if we are dealing with unbounded operators anyhow, why shouldn't we allow that t minus lambda should also be unbounded? But that's a two-weak condition, and we will see why it is good also to consider this as part in the spectrum. Okay, so the continuous part. Okay, so we want a disjoint decomposition of the spectrum. So we say the elements in a continuous spectrum should not be in a point spectrum. Of course, there could be elements in a point spectrum which also have this property here, but we exclude them. So those are complex numbers which are not in a point spectrum. So which means injectivity is not a problem for them, but yeah, the range of t minus lambda, so what is it? It doesn't have to be everything, but it should be dense in H. So this means the inverse t minus lambda inverse exists as an operator on this range, because so we have t minus lambda goes from the domain of t to the range of t minus lambda, and it's injective because you have no, it's, we are not in the point spectrum, and here we require that this range is also dense, so we can just on this range it's bijective, so we can just invert it from the range of t minus lambda to the domain of t minus lambda, which of course is the domain of t, but then if it would be bounded on this domain, then we could extend it to a bounded operator of all of H. Then we would be in a resolvent set, but it could be that this inverse is not a bounded operator, and that's what happens in the continuous spectrum. So this is not bounded. That's a continuous spectrum. So this means it's injective and it's of course surjective on its range, and the range is dense, so at least there is an inverse mapping, but this is not bounded. Okay, so here it is not bounded. Okay, I'm not saying unbounded, because unbounded operators can also be bounded. So I really mean here it's not bounded. Yeah, so that's what we call a continuous spectrum. Yeah, and then of course there is a rest, where the problem is now really with the surjectivity, namely the range can be much too small. So if the range is not even dense in the Hilbert space, then it is clear that we don't have an inverse in any sense. And that's what is called the residual spectrum. So that's what is left if I'm excluding the point spectrum and the continuous spectrum. So sigma r of t are those lambdas which are not in the point spectrum and where the range of t minus lambda is not even dense. In H. So that's where I really have a real problem with the surjectivity. Yeah, okay, but this is clear that in this case we don't have an inverse in any sense. Yeah, okay, and so those are the three possibilities for the spectrum, and we should try to understand a little bit better what all this means, why this is relevant. From finite dimensions, we are only used to the point spectrum. So if you only have worked with matrices, then the continuous spectrum and the residual spectrum are something which you have never seen before. Okay, but of course in functional analysis classes you should have seen things like this, at least for bounded operators. But I want to make a few remarks about this.